Welcome to the video lecture series organized by the PG Department of English, Pioneer College. The chapter I am going to discuss today is titled Eri, written by Pradeepan Pamirikunna. And this is a chapter which is prescribed for the BA English, Common English students studying in the colleges affiliated to Kannur University. And this is prescribed in the text called Multiple Modernities. And this chapter consists of three sections that are taken from the novel Eri, that is written by Pradeepan Pamirikunna, Dr. Pradeepan Pamirikunna. Dr. Pradeepan Pamirikunna is a Dalit scholar who has written extensively on Kerala history and modernity. And this particular chapter, as I already mentioned, consists of three sections that are taken from the novel. The first section consists of two parts. The first part is an introduction scene where the character Eri is introduced to the readers. This happens through an incident that is encountered by a traveler. So a person, he wants to get back, return home after a journey, but unfortunately, you know, he finds himself in the middle of the night, and he does not have any torch, or he does not have any you know, chute to, you know, to show him a way in the darkness. So it is at this point of time that he meets a stranger. And he does not know, you know, who this person is. And this stranger, he gives a medicine to this person, and he applies a medicine on his eyes. And miraculous, miracle or not, immediately the path in front of him, suddenly, you know, he finds it very easy to move in the darkness, and somehow he manages to reach her home without much danger or problems. But the moment he reaches home, the magical effect of the medicine is gone, you know, everything is back to normal. So this is the event from which with which the story or the novel starts. And through this, we are introduced to the character Eri, who is portrayed as a social reformer who is at the forefront of the movements of reformation of the Paraya community. The second part of the first section is related to the discovery of a document related to Eri by a research scholar. And it is by sheer luck that the research scholar actually stumbles upon this very rare document. Rare because he was not able to find, you know, any documents related to his community. It is at such a context that, you know, he discovers such a rare kind of document from the house of a person who, you know, claims that he is a collector of books. This particular section also talks about or also discusses about, or it is also about the lack of documents, the lack of written documents, which involves, is also, you know, lack of documents, which includes history or any such written documents related to the Paraya community. So, what is the reason, you know, behind this absence of any kind of documents related to the community? And what happens when a person or a research scholar wants to actually research on this particular community or any other community on whom there is no documents present? So this is one problem that is raised, you know, as part of this event. So with this, the first section is over, and coming to the second section. The second section is about the recollections of the research scholar's father. How the father of the research scholar remembers AD, you know, who happens to have lived during the period of his father. That is the grandfather of the research scholar. So he remembers AD as a person who always wears white, pure white. And the research scholar, he is not very sure whether this is, you know, whether this is true, or whether his father was also following a commonsensical idea about, you know, white and the purity that it brings to the person wearing it. So the scholar is not very sure about its authenticity. Nevertheless, this is shown, or this is mentioned as an important event that happens in the life of the research scholar, where he, you know, has this opportunity to listen about Eri from his own father. Again, yeah, and this section also talks about the various caste occupations of this community, like you know, people who engage in traditional medicine or vaidyam, and also about people in the community who engage in mantravada, and about people who you know, practice vaidyam or traditional medicine. The research scholar, he is actually very surprised that people belonging to his community, they knew Sanskrit, and the practice of traditional medicine required a knowledge of Sanskrit. So these the people were the practitioners of the traditional medicine were actually very well versed in Sanskrit. So this is one thing that is mentioned in this section. And also he talks about a practice of education, where the Edutashan, or the teacher, used to walk around, you know, going to places and teaching students there. And this was a certain form of education that had existed during that period. That is the second half of the 19th century. So this is the second section. The third section has a more important event that is discussed. It talks about the very practice or belief which is called Parayapedi or Pulapedi, which the author clarifies that. The author clarifies that this particular practice is something that was attributed to the lower caste community to keep them away, to demonize them. So concepts like Parayapedi or Pulapedi was a practice that was created, you know, that was a plot that was constructed by the upper caste or you know, Savarna section of the community to keep these people, to keep the lower caste, you know, away from the society, to demonize them, to keep them away, or to keep them as, to maintain them as, you know, untouchables. And as per the myth of, or as per the narrative of Pulayapedi or Parapedi, Pulapedi or Parayapedi, what it means is that an upper caste woman who is polluted by a lower caste man gets excommunicated from her community for her, you know, for her life or until her death, and she will be forced to, you know, stay away from her family and her community. And so, and the accusation of this practice is always on the lower caste. But in this particular section taken from the novel, Dr. Pradeepan Pamburikunu gives a totally different interpretation of the practice, where he narrates, Eri encountering or coming across an Andarjanam who wants him to actually take her along with him, because she has now become a widow, and her husband, who was who was very aged, there was a huge age difference between the Andarjanam and her husband, who actually passed away, and the Andarjanam now wants Eri to actually take her with him, but Eri declines and says that he has other interests, community interests, which he is more concerned with, and he cannot take the responsibility of the upper caste woman. And this particular section ends with suggestions, which points to the suicide of the Andarjan. And this is how the or this is the end of the chapter. These are the three sections that are included in the chapter called Eri. I'll end this class by reading out from the section about the novel, which is given at the end of the chapter in your text. The novel Eri, published posthumously in 2017, is an exploration into the prehistory of the Paraya caste community in Kerala. The novel narrates the journey of a university research scholar in search of the history of an anonymous Eri, an intercaste who was born of a Paraya and Malaya people belonging to the father is supposed to come from the Paraya community, and mother from the mother belongs to the Malaya community. So Eri is a intercaste. The homeland of Eri is an imaginary region called Parayanarpuram in the old taluk of Kurumbranad in North Kerala. Eri is imagined as a reformer who led the social reformation of the Paraya community in the second half of the 19th century, much before the reform movements, spearheaded by Narayana Guru. The research scholar traces the history of Eri from memories, memoirs and histories, ritualistic performances, gossips, books and other oral and print sources. It historicizes the making of a Paraya community in its transit to modernity, and retells the renaissance of Kerala from a Paraya male perspective. Thank you.
Next is question answer section. The first question: who is Eri? Answer: Eri is the eponymous protagonist of the novel Eri. He is imagined as a social reformer who led the movements of protest and self-assertion among the Paraya community in the second half of the 19th century. Second question: who is the narrator of the novel? The narrator of the novel is a research scholar who is in the search for documents pertaining to the linguistic, literary and cultural history of the Paraya community. Now, third question: why is the character Eri important for the narrator? Answer: the narrator believes that any written, print or oral documents on Eri would help him understand the history of his community. An understanding of the interventions of Eri, a social reformer, would throw light to the community's past, he believed. Fourth question: how did Eri help Raman find his way home? Answer: Eri applied a balm on Raman's eyes. Suddenly, Raman could see in the dark and he reached home safely. Fifth question: why did the father use the phrase white cloth to describe Eri according to the narrator? The researcher was doubtful whether the reference to the white cloth was part of his father's desire to imagine Eri in white. He was not sure if his father was saying the truth or just reproducing the casteist liking for the color white. Sixth question. Describe the mode of teaching practiced by the Irtashanmar. The Irtashanmar would travel from one place to another to teach students. Writing was taught on sand during those times. The seventh question. What happened to the Andarjana? Answer. The Andarjanam wanted to be saved by Eri, but Eri declined her request. He was not ready to take up her responsibility. His primary concern was to uplift his community, who had undergone generations of torture and humiliation in the name of caste. The Andarjanam believed there was no other way to escape and hence committed suicide. Thank you.